Hello, good morning, my dear students.
Good morning, sir.
How are you?
Fine, sir.
Very well. Okay, please sit down. Today we shall discuss ecclesiastical characters dealt with by Chaucer in the general prologue to Canterbury Tales. There are 7 ecclesiastical characters dealt with by Chaucer in the general prologue to Canterbury Tales. These 7 ecclesiastical characters are the prioress, the monk, the friar, the clerk of Oxford, the parson, the sumner, and the partner. Okay? You take them down somewhere. I repeat, the prioress, the monk, the friar, the clerk of Oxford, the parson, the sumner, and the partner. Is that fine?
Yes.
Okay. It may be pointed out at the very outset that Chaucer has given a very true and realistic picture of the ecclesiastical characters of his age. Now, my dear students, do you know who are ecclesiastical characters? Although we are discussing this and I haven't asked you, do you understand what does it mean, ecclesiastical characters? Yes? Well, it's not very clear? Okay, don't worry. Ecclesiastical characters are characters that are related to the church. Okay? That are associated with the church life. Is that fine?
Yes, sir.
Characters who are related to the church are called as ecclesiastical characters. And as I told you in the beginning that there are 7 ecclesiastical characters in the general prologue to Canterbury Tales. Now, on the one hand, Chaucer satirizes the corrupt and worldly minded clergies, and on the other hand, he appreciates the good characters and presents an ideal picture of theirs. So there are 7 ecclesiastical characters. Out of these 7, 5 are corrupt and 2 are good ones. So what does Chaucer do? Chaucer criticizes the corrupt clergymen and he appreciates the good characters. Well, the only ecclesiastical characters whom Chaucer admires and whom we admire also are the clerk of Oxford and the parson, for whom the author has nothing but praise. The other characters belonging to the church are ridiculed and satirized. Chaucer exposes the follies, the absurdities, the monetary greed, the hypocrisy, and on the whole, the irreligious nature of these men of religion. Indeed, we feel greatly depressed and dismayed by the spectacle of these clergymen who are not only most worldly minded but also dishonest, immoral, and corrupt. So, not only in Chaucer's age, even in our age, we find that men of religion are not very genuine, true. They are corrupt. So in fact, you know, it's just the same. Means the way they were in the 14th century or even in earlier centuries, we notice that they are just the same even in the present century. Well, my dear students, it is the abundance of humor in the portrayal of these persons that relieves the depression and dissolves it in laughter. Well, you know, if you wish, we may discuss a separate question also on Chaucer's humor. Because Chaucer's humor is also very important. It is as important as his irony is, as his tongue-in-cheek expressions are, which he uses for his clergymen. When we consider that a large number of the men of religion all over the world, even today, is no better than it was in Chaucer's time, we are driven to the conclusion that human nature has not changed much since then, and that religion has, through the centuries, served largely as a cloak for the nefarious activities of unscrupulous people who resort to the religious profession to promote their own selfish ends. Let us now discuss these seven ecclesiastical characters individually. I'm repeatedly telling you that there are seven ecclesiastical characters. Remember them. Okay? Now, let us discuss them individually. Prioress. The prioress comes first. A study of the conditions prevailing in Chaucer's time would show that Chaucer created this prioress straight from his own world. However, she corresponds to the character of prioresses as they were in the 14th century. True to type, this prioress is essentially well-bred. What do you understand by well-bred? Well-bred is?
Well-off.
Well-off, very nice. Well-off, affluent. Okay. So, she is true to type because she represents her class, she represents the church life, and she is also individualized. What do you understand by saying that a character is individualized? That means, besides being a typical character, that means besides having the characteristics which are representative of his or her class, he or she has some individual characteristics as well. Okay? Now, for example, she has a romantic name. What name she has?
Eglantine.
Eglantine. She has a romantic name, Eglantine. Having probably led a life of refinement in her early years, she indulges in certain vanities, which of course belong either wholly or in part to many nuns of Chaucer's time. A prioress was not expected to swear at all, but Eglantine swears by Saint Loy. Okay, by Saint Loy, remember the name. She swears by Saint Loy, the 7th century courtier turned saint. So I repeat, she swears. By whose name does she swear?
Saint Loy.
Saint Loy. And who was Saint Loy? The 14th century courtier turned saint. Right. Eglantine is depicted as having exaggeratedly good table manners because, as Chaucer says, she always takes pains to imitate the manners of court life. You know, court life happened to be the ideal life. Means they were, you know, aristocratic people. They were elegant and they were very graceful in their gestures, in their behavior, in their deportment. And, you know, like it was a fashion to imitate their style, their way of life. And she would also do the same, as Chaucer points us out. She speaks fluent French. Now, speaking fluent French is again an individual characteristic. Okay, it is an individual characteristics because all prioresses were not good at French. But she speaks fluent French. And although it is not Parisian French is French which is spoken in Paris. It is still French and hence aristocratic. You know, like in India, for example, if you know Hindi, and besides Hindi, you know Urdu and Sanskrit also, you know, that gives you an added quality that enhances your personality. And this was true with the Englishmen as well. If they knew, other languages, especially French, they were considered aristocratic. Means they spoke English, and if they spoke French too fluently, then they were considered aristocratic. So that way we may call prioress, what is her name? Eglantine, to be an aristocratic lady. Eglantine is not always careful about obeying the rules of a position. For example, nuns were forbidden to go on pilgrimages by the 14th century bishops. Yet they frequently did. And Eglantine is among Joseph's pilgrim. Nuns were also forbidden to keep pets of any kind, yet Eglantine possesses little dogs, and she lavishes affection and care upon them, even feeding them with meat and expensive bread. Okay, this again is an individual characteristics. So, you know, say after the lecture, you can also make a note of the typical characteristics and the individual characteristics. So you would know, like, what are the typical characteristics of Eglantine, the prioress, and what are her individual characteristics. This way you can understand a character better. Sometimes, you know, if you get, question like this, write a short sketch of the prioress. Then you will be able to write, means you will be in a position to write a nice character sketch if you make a note of her typical as well as individual characteristics. Now let's move further. Eglantine is personally vain. Vain. What does it mean? Vain. V-A-I-N. Vain. Yes.
Means she is very pompous.
She's very pompous. Yes, she's very pompous. She's very showy. She's very arrogant. She's very proud. Good. So Eglantine is personally vain. Her appearance is important to her, for she displays too much of her broad forehead to the world, and she cannot hide her love for jewelry. Now you see, in India, like, you know about some nuns. Can you name one or two, if you remember?
Mother Teresa.
Mother Teresa, very nice. This is what I was expecting. Now, Mother Teresa, did she also love jewelry and like other things?
No.
No, she didn't. She led a very simple life. So they ought to lead a simple life, whereas our Eglantine doesn't lead a simple life. She is very pompous, very vain. She shows her broad forehead to the world. You know, showing broad forehead, what does it signify? It signifies that she was very affluent. She was very well off. And she wanted the world to notice this. And she cannot hide her love for jewelry also. Her rosary is too elaborate for a nun. And the brooch she wears, bearing an ambiguous motto. Ambiguous, what does ambiguous mean?
Having two meanings.
Having two meanings. Okay, or when the meaning is not clear. Good. So she wears a brooch bearing an ambiguous motto. Remember this motto, okay? And you just take it down. Amor vincit omnia. Amor vincit omnia. A-M-O-R. Amor vincit. V-I-N-C-I-T. Vincit omnia. O-M-N-I-A. Amor vincit omnia. What does it mean?
Love conquers all.
Love conquers all. Very good. Love conquers all. Now, love conquers all. This is what she wears, this brooch, and it. Now, it has. Now this is an ambiguous expression. Love conquers all. Question arises: sacred or profane love? Profane love means mundane love. Should not be worn by a nun. Although Chaucer does criticize the prioress for her vanities and for her disregard of the rules, however, the blame is extremely mild. You know, Chaucer, when he criticizes his ecclesiastical characters, his criticism is very mild. It's very genial. It's not pungent. The poet makes her quite charming. Though her graceful femininity may not be tolerated by those who are strictly religious. You know, Chaucer is very mild in her satire, but you know, if we like see her by the yardstick of other clergymen, say bishops or priests and all, they wouldn't find her a nice character. Okay, they would find fault with her because she was too worldly. So this is our prioress, and now next character that we come across in the prologue is monk. I have taken down some important points to discuss, and so I am discussing these characters broadly and in detail, I may say, so that you can make a note of them while discussing their character sketches separately. The monk is also satirically portrayed. He contemptuously ignores the vows he has taken to uphold the rules of monastic discipline laid by Saint Maurice and Saint Benedict. His greatest pleasure is in hunting the hare, which was thought to be wicked, especially for the clergyman. Now, this one is an individual characteristic. Like, what does he enjoy? He enjoys hunting the hare. This was something wicked, okay, very unkind, especially for a clergyman. He neither labors with his hands nor pores over a book in the cloister. The monk doesn't fast or deny himself costly garments. Instead, he loves a fat swan, the best of any rose. He wears the finest gray fur in the land, an elaborate gold pin in the shape of a love knot, and costly supple boots. So again, we find that monk is very worldly. Okay? He is not very religious. He loves his cloister. And Chaucer reminds us that a monk outside the cloister is like a fish out of water. He owns greyhounds, which are swift as birds, and in the stable are many valuable horses. Thus, Chaucer's monk is a lively representative of his class. On the other hand, however, Chaucer gives the portrait added vitality and strength by a few individual touches. On the one hand, Chaucer tells us that this monk is typical of his class because he represents the characteristics which a clergyman ought to possess. So he's a type, but he's also individualized by Chaucer. The monk, for instance, has a large, prominent eyes and glistening ruddy face. He is bald and stout, and his pomposity and implied resentment against the world are quite evident. Means he is not very soft spoken. He is very rude, and this resentment against the world are quite evident. Okay, now we move on to the next character, Friar. The Friar, to begin with, is a representative of his class and very much himself as well. When we say very much himself as well, very much himself, that means he is also individualized like the other characters, as we notice, the prioress, for example, or the monk, for example. So he is also individualized. He is very much himself. He is a limiter. Who is a limiter? Limiter is a person who has secured the begging rights in a specified area. That means he has a territory of his own and he has secured the begging right there in that specified area, in his territory. He knows how to induce all the women in that area to give him money or food in response to deliance. Now, deliance is a new word, I suppose, for you. This is spelled as D-A-L-L-I-A-N-C-E. Deliance. Deliance means flirtation, or say pleasant gossip for that matter. Obviously, he has a way with him. His English is sweet upon his tongue, as he has affected a lisp. This is again a very individual characteristic and a very sweet characteristic. You know, this makes him unique. What does he do? His tongue is affected with a lisp. Okay? He knows all the latest songs with which he entertains the fair ladies while he accompanies himself upon a harp. So this again is a very individual characteristic. So, you know, like when we notice their individual characteristics, I mean their idiosyncrasies, the way they behave, their gestures, their manners, their deportment, we really find them very fascinating. And that is why Chaucer has made his characters very memorable and remarkable. Means they simply become unforgettable for you. You are going to remember these characters for ages together, I'm telling you. He rewards the ladies with handsome presents of ornamental knives and pins. And his initial blessing of each home he visits is pleasantly satisfying. When he visits richer or more important people, his manner changes. He is now courteous and humble. He is only too ready to hear confessions and to sell ablution for money, which is of course his greatest sin. He has other faults too. He will have nothing to do with lepers or with the poor. You know, we ought to be very, kind with the lepers, for example, or with the poor, but he is not. He is very callous, very unkind to them. He treats only the rich in a nice and courteous manner. He will deal only with those who can be a source of profit to him in some way. The wealthy, for example, the sellers of food and the barmaids in taverns, etc. They are important to him because they are a source of profit to him. And that is why they are treated with
courteousness.
Courtesy. Very nice. Okay? Means he is very kind to them. He is very respectful to them. He meddles also in civil affairs. For on love days, he acts as an arbitrator to settle disputes and makes money by this means too. He is courteous and humble in rendering service whenever there is a possibility of making any money. That means he is a thorough mercenary. A mercenary is a person, you know, who is very particular about money. Making more and more money. So money is very important to him. There is no man anywhere so virtuous, says Chaucer ironically. This thing I like about Chaucer. You know, Chaucer would be criticizing a character and later on he would say, you won't find any man like the monk, so virtuous, so nice, so courteous, so modest. Okay, this is tongue in cheek. This is the speciality of Chaucer. Okay, this is a kind of genial sarcasm. He is sarcastic, okay, he is criticizing, but the criticism is very mild.